I'd like to welcome everybody to the college complexes. My name is Tim. I'll be videotaping this tonight for posterity for release on our YouTube channel. Since we're going to have a good presentation tonight, we're having Bob Matter. I'd like to welcome now our moderator, Don, to come on up and...
Welcome to the College of Complexes. As Tim said, my name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. Just tell you very briefly what our presentation is this evening. Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb. The Hiroshima bombing was right and necessary. And our speaker is, of course, Bob Matter. This being August 27th, this is the anniversary of the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and also President Obama's visit to the Pease Memorial in Japan. So Bob Matter is going to reveal little-known Japanese military secrets and offer justification for the quick and decisive nuclear conclusion to the war in the Pacific. So then let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker this evening, Bob Matter. All right.
Thank you, Don. Welcome, everybody. So, this is a kind of a rerun of a speech I gave about 5 or 6 years ago. And as it turns out, every August that rolls around, the Marxists and the Hate America Firsters start coming out of the closet, and you see these articles appearing in newspapers, like this one here by Dennis Kucinich, Sunday, August 7th, 2016, 71st anniversary of the dropping of the nuclear bombs on Japan. It is widely believed that this was a necessary act. It wasn't. And you see these all the time. Every year these come out, so I figure I need to, you know, resurface occasionally and set the record straight.
Hey, I posted that on Facebook.
Yeah, thanks to Charlie for posting that. Last November in 2015, there was a survey done, and they asked Americans, if they favored or disfavored the dropping of atomic bombs on Japan to end World War II, and we've reached a new low now. Only 56% of Americans approve of the bombing now. Now, back when, I think the first time they did the survey in like 49 or something, 1949, 80% of the people approved of the dropping of the bomb. So that reflects mostly a change in the values of young people who are, first of all, influenced by this creeping Marxism that's infiltrated our schools and universities. And second of all, the people that don't have anything at stake, that weren't, as Joe Sixpack told me tonight, the people that weren't facing a beachhead themselves, don't think it's so necessary. But you would have had a vastly different opinion if you were going to be one of the ones shipped over there to invade. Now, one thing I didn't talk about last time, I don't think, but we should bring up in a little more detail is, at the time, at the end of World War II in Europe, we were having a massive demobilization. We were a war-weary country. We lost a lot of people, spent a lot of treasure, and the guys in Europe, they wanted to get back home. One thing that weighed heavily on everybody's mind was the fear that we would slip back into the Depression if the war ended and the war spending ended. So the guys that had the most points racked up, and you got points for your length of service and the combat days you had been in and the major campaigns you had been in, these all counted towards your points. And when you reached a certain level of points,
hey Bob, would you please be more quiet, okay?
So So when you reached a certain level of points, you were eligible for demobilization. These guys wanted to come home and get their jobs back first. They wanted to be the first ones back to get their jobs because everybody was afraid the economy would just resume its collapse back into depression again. So, and there was a tremendous amount of political pressure on the politicians in the United States to bring the boys home. People's families wanted them to come home. Politicians and generals, you know, everybody was getting, you know, duffel bags full of mail from constituents saying, dear General Eisenhower, I've been trying to keep the farm up since my husband's been gone, but I'm trying to raise three daughters and blah, blah, blah. I just can't do it. I need my husband back home on the farm. I can't keep up with all this. And so that was a continuous thing. And then also, Americans wanted consumer goods. People wanted to start buying things again. They've been rationed and couldn't buy tires, couldn't buy cars, couldn't buy a lot of things. So there was a tremendous pressure to bring the war to an end. So they started demobilizing, and some units had dropped down to as low as, some of them had 80% of their guys were rotated out. They had new guys in. And the thing was that once Europe was wrapped up, those guys then were going to be shipped over to Japan for the planned invasion, which was planned to take place, I believe, on November 1st. I believe they were planning the invasion of Japan. The first one, they were going to do a two-phase invasion. They were going to invade the lower island, Kyushu, first, and then use that as a land base, and then invade the northern island, Honshu, which is where Tokyo is, and the mass of the people live. They were going to invade that one next. But first they had to get a toehold where they could have a ground base for aircraft and things like that. Well, how do you think some of these GIs felt in Europe that had just gone through the invasion of Normandy, had just gone through the Hurgen Forest and the Battle of the Bulge, and now they're getting ready to get shipped to Japan to, you know, fight again. Or if they fought their way up from Italy and then got transferred, to Europe. That was not a popular thing. Also at the time, there were about 300,000 Allied prisoners in captivity by the Japanese. And compared to the Japanese to the Germans, well, being a German prisoner, that'd be like staying in the Hilton compared to being a Japanese prisoner. Japanese were just barbaric. You had a 35% chance of dying in captivity if you were an Allied prisoner in Japan or being held by Japan. They would work you to death. You would basically be starved to death. You would not get any medical care. You were very likely to die of a disease if you got sick. Malnutrition. They were giving the prisoners rice that had gone through a process that was like scrubbing that took the protein out of the rice, so it was just like stomach filler, but it had no nutrient value. And of course, they were subject to constant beatings, beheadings, just terrible abuse, torture. In Germany, you only had about a 1 or 2% chance of dying in captivity if you were captured by Germans. And that was no picnic either over there. I mean, I knew prisoners of war from Germany that were in Germany, and it was no picnic, but it wasn't anywhere near as brutal as in Japan. After some of the guys were released, there was a war correspondent named Weller that interviewed some Allied prisoners in Japan and shortly after the end of the war. And I remember one of them told Weller that having an orange peel was a luxury, an orange peel. That's how bad it was. Now, if you were lucky enough to be an Allied prisoner, you only had a 35% chance of dying. If you were one of the many Asian prisoners from the populace of the countries they conquered, you stood a 50% chance of dying. And there was, I can't remember the exact figure, but something like 10 million, maybe up to 20 million Asians had died as a result of being enslaved by the Japanese. And of course, there was pretty lousy record keeping, and a lot of the stuff was kind of out in remote areas, so we don't really know exactly for sure what went on, but there was a lot of people. So, it was sort of against those backdrops that we decided to drop the bomb, or bombs. Now, and this is not something that Truman really had decided to do. I believe he did give it the final go-ahead. But it was pretty much assumed that when the program started, that when these bombs were done, they were going to be dropped. I mean, this was a continuation of Roosevelt's plan. I don't think Truman ever even considered that they would not be dropped. He was going to go right along with what Roosevelt had already in plan, and the plan was, create these bombs and drop them. And the reason, people say, well, one of the things that we hear from the left all the time is, you didn't have to drop that second bomb. You could have just dropped, you could have just did Hiroshima. The Nagasaki, they didn't have to do that one, blah, blah, blah. Well, what we wanted to do was create the appearance to the Japanese rulers, or Hirohito and the gang of eight guys that basically ran Japan. We wanted to give the appearance that we had capacity to crank these bombs out, and that we would use as many of them as necessary to end the war. So by dropping that second bomb in close, time to the first bomb, that put the pressure on the Japanese. Now, we really only had those two. That was it. We weren't really sure, if they would work. We only tested the plutonium bomb, which was dropped on Nagasaki. That was tested at Trinity. It was at that Trinity test site down in southwest United States. And the first one, the Hiroshima bomb, the uranium bomb, they did not test, but they just figured theoretically it should work. One of the other criticisms that the left has is they should have used a demonstration bomb somewhere. They could have dropped this, off the coast on an uninhabited island and then showed it to the Japanese. But if it would not have exploded, or something would have went wrong, then we'd look pretty stupid. That would probably just empower the Japanese to keep fighting. So we dropped it over a military target. Hiroshima was the headquarters of the Second General Army of Japan. There's a very large military presence there. They had some other military-related things going on. And also in Nagasaki, this bomb was dropped near the Mitsubishi engine plant, and there was also a torpedo plant there. So these were also desirable military targets. Now they were kind of a little off course, and ended up dropping the bomb over a Catholic church. So that was unintentional, and it was a big. It happened to be some Saints' Day too, or something. So there was a big congregation present, and all that stuff. So yeah, a lot of Catholics got wiped out. Now the Japanese had thought for a long time that they were wondering why Nagasaki had been spared being bombed, while other cities had been being bombed, conventionally by B-29s, And they thought, well, because we have this large Catholic population, allies aren't bombing us. There's a lot of Catholic allies. But really, the reason was really there were more important targets to be bombed conventionally than Nagasaki was the main consideration. Getting to these places was not so easy. Weather is a big factor. Japan is a very difficult place to bomb. They have really high winds at high altitudes, and it's very often cloudy. They have very few good bombing days, good visible bombing days. Bombing by radar is kind of difficult. In those days, it was difficult. And bombing was not a precise science at the time yet either. We had tried bombing, individual targets, but sometimes a bomb would be a mile away from the target, or the bombs would land a mile away from the target, or else they wouldn't do very much damage. We were principally going after places like aircraft manufacturing was a big thing. Anything that had anything to do with aircraft. Well, we're doing such a dismal job of hitting the factories or doing much damage to them. I mean, in a couple days, they'd be right back in business again. They had to start going after civilians. That turned out to be a little more effective. The other thing was, though, the thing that Japan was doing was they had these feeder system, it's called, where individual homes scattered all around the city would have a drill press or a lathe or a milling machine or something in them, and they would make parts right there at home. And then when they get a pallet load full of them or whatever, they'd be trucked off to the factory. And we know this because when you look at the photographs of some of these cities that have been firebombed, you see these. You see everything be burned to the ground because these Japanese homes are generally made out of wood and paper, so they burn right to the ground. But then, standing in the middle of the floor would be a drill press or something, or a lathe, still standing there. But by starting to bomb civilians, that sort of became a necessary thing to do. Bombing at high altitude and at night was probably the safest thing for pilots and crew, but it was led to dismal hitting of targets. It was just, you just couldn't hit the targets. And if you bombed in the daytime and at low altitude, then you were subject to being shot down, either by anti-aircraft fire or by fighter jets.
No, not fighter jets.
Not fighter, I mean fighter planes, I mean. Japan did buy the jet technology from Germany. I don't think they had any workable jets actually in the air at the time, though. But they did buy plans and the rights from Germany, though, to do that. Now, you constantly hear the left saying, "Oh, the Japanese, they're putting out peace feelers way back, go back several months." They say it's in the intercepted records we had and all that. Well, I read a whole book. It was basically a summary of all the important intercepted messages called Marching Orders by a gentleman named Bruce Lee, no relation to the karate actor, I don't think. But it was written in 1995. It was quite a hefty book, 608 pages, but it was quite interesting, and it contained both the German and Japanese codes, intercepted coded messages. But the Japanese were sending out peace feelers, but they were not agreeing to an unconditional surrender like we wanted. What they were doing was appealing to the Russians over and over and over again, trying to get on the good side of the Russians, trying to form a partnership or an alliance with Russia. you know, they could see, you know, the writing on the wall that, you know, the war was going to be over, and basically it was going to be Russia against America and Britain for the spoils of war and for the, you know, following Cold War that was coming afterwards. So they were appealing to Russia, saying, hey, you know what, why don't we split China? You know, we can occupy China, and we can do this, and we can do that. They had all these little things they wanted to do with Russia. They said, okay, we'll let you have these fishing rights in this area, we'll give you these ports, and blah, blah, blah. And they kept making all these, you know, motions towards Russia, but Russia denied that. They knew, you know, Stalin had already made an agreement with Roosevelt and then Truman that he was going to enter the war 90 days after the end of the war in Europe. He was going to enter in Japan, and we had agreed to already let him have ports and fishing rights and all that kind of stuff, and give him some land, you know, give them some land back that they had lost in the earlier Russian-Japanese War, I guess that was in 1905 or something. So Stalin didn't need to have any deals with the Japanese, because he was already going to get that stuff anyway. So they had a neutrality pact. I mean, up until that point, there was a neutrality pact with Russia and Japan. But shortly before the invasion, they broke the pact. They gave Japan notice that they would not be renewing the pact. And that put Japan on notice that, uh-oh, you know, we're going to get invaded. But, you know, the left also likes to give credit to, you know, Russia as being the force that caused Japan to capitulate. But that, when you look at all the details, when you read all the records, excuse me, that is also not true. We wanted Russia's involvement in the war because we figured we were going to have to invade, and maybe whether we dropped the atomic bombs or not, we were planning for the invasion, and we figured that if there was a Russian attack from the north, that would prevent Japan from pulling its troops out of Manchuria and strengthening Kyushu, the lower island we were going to invade first. And that, in fact, was the case. You know, they did not pull people out from Manchuria to reinforce. Although they did, they might pull some out, but not, you know, not a whole bunch. They really did beef up the security though on Kyushu. I mean, they were planning for a long drawn out invasion and ground war. They knew they were going to lose. I mean, they had. Their navy was pretty much destroyed. We had thought that their air force was pretty much destroyed, but it turns out they had several thousand planes, and they got everything that could fly, training planes, anything that could fly, they adapted into a kamikaze plane, and they had just enough fuel in them to leave the island of Kyushu and then fly to an invasion force offshore. They didn't have to have big landing strips because these planes were not coming back. All they needed was enough room to take off. So what they did is they had a little mowed lawn, and they had these planes sitting underneath trees, hidden in all kinds of caves and buildings and things like that. And they had amassed 5,000, 6,000, or 7,000 of these things. And taking out a kamikaze plane is quite difficult, because most ships are equipped with only one large gun that is sufficient for taking out a plane that's locked into a dive. The smaller caliber guns they had, which would be typical anti-aircraft type things, when a plane is just locked into a dive, it's coming at you at that velocity, the bolts just pass through it and it would not blow it up or redirect it. needed, they called a 5-inch gun to actually stop a plane. But a lot of ships only had one of these guns. And you may be under attack from 4 or 5 different kamikaze planes at one time. So they were quite deadly, quite a threat. Not only did they have these planes ready to go, but they also had all kinds of submarines that were equipped to be essentially kamikaze subs. Some of these mini subs, they had a couple different types of mini subs. And some of them, they just basically turned in, they would load the nose with 1,200 pounds of high explosives, and they were just turning these things basically into manned torpedoes. And this was all geared to hit an invasion force. So the whole idea was they knew they were going to lose, but they thought if we can draw America into an invasion and do a messy ground war, after we lose about 30,000 or 50,000 people, then the American public will demand an end of the war, and that we will give in and allow them the conditions that they want. Now, we wanted unconditional surrender, period. The Japanese did not want occupation. They did not want to, they wanted to be in charge of gathering their own weapons and putting them away and stuff like that. They had a few other things. I believe they were willing to give up some of the land they had gotten, or some they wanted to keep, or they had all kinds of little Christmas ornaments on their idea of surrender. And the idea was that they wanted to regrow their military and come back someday. And you know, you have to understand, Japan was a warrior culture. They had these guys that ran the military were from Kyushu. That was sort of the home base of the samurai. And you know, being a strong military force, that was their thing. I mean, and they were not. They just did not want to back down. They did not want to surrender. You know, the night before Hirohito's surrender message was broadcast to the public, you know, there was an attempted coup by some military guys. They broke into the palace and were trying to find the record of the album. The speech had been recorded on an album, so all they had to do was play this at radio stations and broadcast it to the Japanese public. And fortunately, it was locked away in a vault somewhere in a basement of the palace, and the handful of guys in the crew couldn't find it. And the revolt was put down, but nonetheless, there was still a strong military threat of a military coup, of a military takeover. Now, we were quite worried at the time that there would be a breakdown if there had been a coup. There perhaps could have been civil unrest, and the whole damn place would have collapsed into chaos and anarchy. We didn't really want that, so we decided, well, we could probably go along with allowing Hirohito to stay in power. And we could maybe use him when the war is over to help convince the Japanese in the regions outside of Japan and other countries like the Philippines and Malaysia and Burma and Singapore and all that, convince them to lay down their arms and stop fighting. There's a lot of those guys out there too. They were the remotely stationed Japanese. They were determined to fight to the bitter end as well. But just the guys in they called them the Big Eight. It was like there were 6 military leaders in there, and then there was Hirohito and his assistant or his aide called Kido, keeper of the Privy Seal. So those two made up the other two. So there was basically a cabinet of 8. The other 6 consisted of like a prime minister and a foreign minister, and then there was a couple guys from the Navy and a couple guys from the Army. And it was these military guys that really pretty much ran the show, and pretty much ran the show all through Japan up until that time.
Pardon me.
Well, this plan to draw America into a long invasion in order to get us to relax our terms of surrender. Oh, matter of fact, one of the other things that the Japanese wanted was they wanted to try and prosecute their own war criminals. They didn't want somebody else doing it. Crazy, it was crazy. So anyway, but the name of this plan to draw Americans in and then have a battle was called Ketsugo. Ketsugo, and it sort of meant like the decisive battle. That's what it means in English. To fight the decisive battle. And shortly before the end of the war, basically all civilians, men between about, I think, 14 and 60, were made part of the army, made military. And all women from about 14 to 40 were also conscripted into the military. So essentially, there were no civilians, if you look at it that way. Everybody was in the army. You know, they were planning on, you know, having civilian warfare during Ketsugo. Only the very young and the very old would not need to participate. And you know, that is fighting civilians, you know, door to door, that is a very bloody, costly way to fight a war. And we allowed the Russians to take Berlin. Now, officially, the Russians said they lost 100,000 men taking Berlin. But you know how the Russians like to fudge on things, and they think that they may have lost 300,000 men rather than 100,000. That might have been the true loss. But fighting door to door, you know, is just it's horrible. And you have, and something the Japanese even just, we knew from fighting them in the islands, you know, that they just won't give up. Okay, and they'll lay there and, you know, yell for help, they're wounded, and they're waving a white flag, and then you'd go up to help them, and then they would pull a pin on a grenade and blow them up and you up, you know. Civilians were being given, you know, spears and anything to fight with, so this was going to be a nasty, bloody thing. Plus, remember, you have this demobilization going on. Some of these units that would be invading would be full of greenhorns, guys that have never fought before, and all of a sudden they're going up against these Japanese who are just fierce. And Kyushu was just loaded to the gills. They had, you know, dozens of divisions, tanks, tank divisions. Now they did not have a lot of they didn't have a lot of fuel. They didn't have a lot of ammunition, but nonetheless, they're still a pretty potent force, and there's so many of them. And they're so well dug, you know, pretty well dug in. Not as well as they could be, but they were still dug in. They had, you know, tunnels and all that stuff, caves, and just like they did in the other islands. Now, there are four probably large events that the left overlooks when they criticize the dropping of the bomb. They say, oh, no, we didn't have to bomb. We could have just had the blockade and the air bombing, and you know, they would have surrendered after that. Well, the number one factor, the biggest thing, was their railroad system. Japan really had no road system. 97% of the roads were unpaved, and they were totally dependent on railroads to get their rice, their main food crop, distributed. Most of Japan lives in Honshu, the middle islands, where Tokyo is, but they live in the southwest. Food is grown in Hokkaido, which is the far northern island of the three big ones, and it's also grown in Kyushu, and then shipped by rail to Honshu. Some northern Honshu has some growing as well. But there were some weather problems in 1945, so the rice crop wasn't coming in very well. We had pretty much decimated the merchant marines, so they had been stealing about 10 or 20% of the Koreans' rice, but that wasn't getting in anymore. And the fishing was down. They used to get quite a few of you'd meet their daily caloric requirements by fish, but fishing was down. So they were facing starvation. And had we not used atomic bombs, if we would have bombed conventionally, the targets that were left, as if we didn't want to just bomb civilians. And at this point, we thought, well, we don't really want to bomb civilians. But if we invade, though, we're going to have to bomb the railroad tracks. And if we do that, they're going to starve. They'll be starving by November, and certainly by the early months of 1946. You're going to have, millions of people starving. And we sort of didn't want to bomb the railroads because we knew that we were going to be occupying them. And if we bombed the railroads, we knew that they didn't have the equipment or the resources to repair the railroads if they were bombed. And if we bombed them, then we're going to come over there and occupy them. We have all these millions of starving people and no way to get it. It's going to be a big hassle to get food moved around and distributed. So, but that's one thing we could have done. We could have starved them to death. Okay, we could have bombed the railroads, and we would have had millions of people starving instead of losing 100 or 200,000 people in the atomic bomb blast. We would have lost millions, from starvation. So that's not so great. The other thing to look at was the Soviet intervention. Did we want the Soviets, to firmly, come further and further south? And once they get ingrained in there, it's very difficult to get them out. So we would like, we wanted to kind of end the war as swiftly as possible with as little Russian intervention as possible, so we wouldn't have to deal with them. The American invasion strategy was kind of in a constant state of flux. We thought people kept thinking, well, maybe we shouldn't invade the southern island first. Maybe we should just invade the northern islands first, since they kind of concentrated everything in the south, figuring that's where we were going to land. So that left the north weakened. And I believe MacArthur's, was kind of favoring that idea. MacArthur was more or less head of the Pacific operations over there. I believe he wanted to do that. There was a lot of disarray in the American camp of where and when to invade. The other thing was, it was coming on to be typhoon season. And again, these typhoons in Japan, man, they are nothing to play with. There was a typhoon on October 9th, after the war. A typhoon came in on October 9th. And it sunk about eight ships off of Okinawa and grounded 222 more, only 80 of which were ever put back out to sea. And about 80 Americans were killed, and 120 or so were seriously injured. Had we planned, gone ahead with the invasion on November 1st, the invasion force would have been out to sea on October 15th. And who knows what would have happened. That could have been a real calamity. There were some other bad weather things going on with them. So typhoon season was coming along, which is making the invasion difficult. And something I forgot to mention, I'm going to go back up to point number one, the railroad situation and the starvation. Who's going to starve first if there was a cutoff of food? 300,000 Allied prisoners, that's who. And they would probably be starved, and then they might even be eaten. The Japanese were not shy about even killing their own soldiers. Officers would even have their own soldiers killed and eaten in some cases. So, but you know for sure when there was a shortage of food, prisoners would be the first one to starve, and then probably all the slaves that they had. From the other, the enslaved, the Filipinos, the Chinese, the Koreans, the Malaysians, all those people. So point number four was the impact of the war on Chinese and the other Asian countries. So this was something we also had to consider. Every day we keep allow these people to be kept in bondage, the misery that they're going through. Rapes and beatings and starvings and all that. And my probably last point is, the Japanese had their own nuclear program. They had a nuclear program, they also had a biological weapons program. Now, they had a nuclear program, but they weren't as sharp as we were, as advanced yet. So they thought it took a lot more uranium to make a bomb than it did. So they kind of wrote it off and said, no, this is going to be impossible. So they were kind of surprised when we blew up our first bombs. As a matter of fact, they didn't even think they were atomic bombs at first. They captured an American crew member. I believe a B-29 got shot down. All the guys were executed that they captured, except one. They asked him if he knew how the atomic bomb worked, and they were beating it out of him. So he decided to lie just to save his life. He said, "Yeah, I'll tell you." So they shipped him up to Tokyo, and they had a bunch of generals and come in and listen to him, and he explained. Said, "Well, the Americans have figured out how to separate the positive charged particles from the negative charged particles in the atmosphere." So they have this big box. It's about 24 feet by 36 feet. I don't know how tall, he didn't say how tall it was. He said, but they have a lead curtain in the middle of this box separating the positive from the negative particles. And he goes, then they melt they have a timer or something, and it melts the lead wall in the middle, and when the positives and negatives meet, it creates a giant lightning bolt. And so they believed it, And within a few days later, they had a Japanese atomic physicist come in, and they made him tell the story to him. And then he walked back out. He said, "That guy's full of shit. That's not how it works." But by him lying, he prolonged. He ended up staying alive, because at that time, then the war was, a few days later, the war was over, and he was still alive. But the rest of the guys got killed. They were in this crew. But the other thing is, they had given up sort of on their own atomic plan. But they did have a very active biological weapons plan, and I believe it was the principal place was called Harbin in China,
Manchuria,
and they were creating the plague and anthrax and some other nasty things, and testing this out on Chinese civilians. And they were planning on spreading it over here. As a matter of fact, they had built this class of submarines, they call them the I-400s. They were these combination submarines and aircraft carriers that would carry, they had three airplanes inside of them. First they were gonna send one of these subs over to the Panama Canal. These were humongous submarines, by the way. They had enough fuel to easily make a round trip from Japan to the United States, either going east or west. They could come to the United States and back very easily. They had a tremendous amount of fuel. So these things could stay out at sea for a long time. They had three planes in them. They would bring these planes up, catapult them off the deck, or they would bolt on these flotation devices so they look like a seaplane. And they would launch them off the deck. They'd be able to fly over a city like San Diego or Miami, a couple of garden cities, of course, New York and Washington, D.C. And they'd be like a craft vessel. They could fly over and drop anthrax or plague or fleas infected with plague over a city. And then these planes would fly back to the sub. The sub would go underwater while the planes were out flying. At a certain time, the subs would come back up, the planes would land, and then they would have a crane that would, you know, pick them up and put them back up on the deck, and they would dismantle them and put them back away and take off again. And they could do this at nighttime, and they could be seen. They painted the parts of these planes with luminescent paint so they could see, in the dark. They could assemble these things out on the top of the deck and all that, and put them away, build them and put them away. Well, their plane, fortunately for us, unfortunately for them, by the time these submarines were built, it was at the end of the war, basically, and they just didn't have enough of them built. They only had a few built, and the first project was to do the Panama. They wanted to bomb the locks of the Panama Canal. That was going to be the first goal. And actually, the first goal was to use, these planes were going to be used as kamikaze planes. They were just going to crash right into the gates of the Panama Canal. Because they figured that would, cause us a delay in invading Japan, because we'd have to go all the way around South America, and come up with the invasion forces and stuff, instead of taking the shortcut to the Panama Canal. Well, since the invasion time was getting near that we were going to invade Japan, the Russian military strategists decided to scrap that idea. They're going to need all available subs and everything to fight the invasion force, to protect the homeland. That was going to be the major thing. So they canceled the plan to bomb the Panama Canal. And we ended up capturing one of the subs still in port, and another one I believe was sunk somewhere out in the Pacific. The Russians wanted to come aboard and inspect the one that we had captured. We didn't want them to see it and get any ideas, so we sailed it to Hawaii and sunk it off the coast of Oahu, where it still sits about 600 feet down. How am I doing on time?
It's about 7:24.
Okay.
We should break off soon.
Okay. So anyway, the moral of that little end story there is that don't cry too big a crocodile tears for Japan, because they did not care about bombing innocent people or civilians when they bombed Pearl Harbor, and they certainly didn't care about them when they raided Nanking, or when they were testing their biological weapons on the Chinese, and they were certainly going to drop biological weapons on us over here in our cities. So don't fall for that. Don't cry too big of tears for them. And the other thing is also the devastation of that. Every year it seems like the number of people that died and injured in these atomic bombings seems to get worse and worse. Every year it grows. But there is factual data out there. We had sent some teams in to inspect things, and they had the numbers. But the Japanese realized early on that they could take the role of a victim and use this as propaganda to get sympathy and favored nation trade status and all that. So of course every year they have the press come out and have all this, the moments of silence, and floating the candles on the river, and all this. They have the traveling museum things. They had this thing at the Smithsonian some time ago. So they really play it up, you know, the part of the victim. But again, that's, you know, basically, you know, propaganda. So take all that with a grain of salt, based on what I told you tonight. If you're interested in reading a good description of all this stuff, this is my primary source, Downfall, by Richard D. Franks. Really quite a good book. He does go into a lot of detail, so there's some points here where, you know, you'll probably be dragging your eyes when he talks about the number of divisions here and there, the number of the tons of bombs here and there, and all that stuff. Quite detailed, but still a lot of good stuff. Right. The other books I read for this presentation, of course, were Marching Orders by Bruce Lee, 1995, which is summaries of the Magic and Ultra intercepts. That was the German and Japanese communications that we intercepted and decoded. And also The Fall of Japan by William Craig, published in 1967. That's 368 pages. And the I believe you might be able to find it online somewhere. PBS ran a program called Secrets of the Dead for a while. It was a series called Secrets of the Dead. And one of them was called Japanese Super Sub. And it was all about the I-400. And I believe that is where I might have seen the, they might have talked a little bit about the biological weapons, but might have been another. I saw a film at Facets some years ago, a documentary about the biological program, so I might have got some of that from there. Can't remember the name of that film. It's been too many years past. But, and finally, I'd like to say that Hirohito had recorded in his memoirs the three reasons why he wanted to end the war. And his number one thing he was worried about was domestic upheaval. Because of the fact that people were, you know, facing starvation, and there'd been a lot of conventional bombing, you know, a lot of homes in Tokyo had been burned up, I think a quarter of them were burned down and things. So he was quite worried that there would be a people's revolt or a revolution that would take him out of power, and he didn't want that, because, you know, the Emperor of Japan is seen as a living god. It was at that time, anyway. And it had this link, this 2,600-year, you know, link going back, an uninterrupted chain of relatives. And so he didn't want to interrupt that. And number two, his number two reason was that he thought that their military was would not be able, or they were inadequately prepared to fight an invasion from the Allies. And number three was the destructiveness of the atomic bombs. And he did not cite, at that time anyway, he did not cite the Russians. He was just worried about those particular three things. And Suzuki, who was the foreign minister, I believe it was, I think he summed it up the best. He's the prime minister of Japan from April to August of 45. He said, the Supreme War Council was making every possible preparation to meet an American landing. They proceeded with that plan until the atomic bomb was dropped, after which they believed the United States would no longer attempt to land when it had such a superior weapon. That the United States need not land when it had such a weapon, so at that point they decided that it would be best to sue for peace. So in other words, the atomic bombing just blew their whole Ketsu-Go plan of trying to draw Americans into a land war so we would capitulate to their surrender, you know, to their need or their wants as far as the surrender. Once they realized that, hey, we don't have to invade, we'll just, you know, bomb the shit out of you, you know, to rubble, they said, oh, there's no point in you know, catch and go is not going to work because they don't have to invade us. So with that, I will end my discussion and take your questions.
Okay, great. Okay, we get into the question and answer session, and I see that a lot of people have got questions. So we'll start with you, Pat.
Yeah, I understand that if we were to go through the Japanese behavior before and during World War II, we have an unbroken list of atrocities which would make anyone in this room puke if they were recited in detail. How many war criminals did we execute among the Japanese military and their officials after the war?
Yeah, great question, and I don't know.
I ask this because we know.
Wait, the question. Pat asked how many war criminals, Japanese war criminals, we executed after the war, and actually I don't know. It's an area I have not studied.
I ask this because we know a lot about the executions of the German war criminals, some of whom were actually minor officials. But we don't know a heck of a lot about how many Japanese officials were executed, and anyone familiar with that part of World War II would be aware of the fact that their crimes were at least as bad as what was going on in Germany, if not worse.
Yeah, the only close thing I could give to an answer to that is something I read that said that the reason we know so much more about Europe and what happened to the Jews is because basically at that time the media had a lot more Jewish representation in it than it did with than Asians, so that helped bring a lot more of that to the public sphere.
All right, Dave Singer.
I read that the real reason that the United States, I think a book by a man named Horowitz, that the real reason the United States dropped the atomic bomb on Japan was to demonstrate to the Soviets they better behave, and if they don't behave, they're going to get the same treatment.
Oh, yeah, that's also one of the mainstays of myths of the left. Yeah, same thing. But again, the people who say that, they don't consider the 4 points I gave you, especially number one, that the impending starvation, had we not dropped the bomb and brought this war to a quick close, if we would have let it drag on and wait it out, how many millions would have starved, including the 300,000 prisoners that they had, not including hundreds of thousands of enslaved people they had. Philippines and Malaysia and everywhere else.
I don't think that that the government care about who lives and who dies. Just a matter of
love. And I'll tell you what though, you know what? Is it such a bad thing to display that to the Russians? We wanted our guys to come home from Europe. Russia had a huge standing army left in Europe. By having atomic weapons, that allowed us to bring our people home and not have such a large force there to meet the Russian threat.
Okay. I want to ask a follow-up question to Dave Singer's question. Now, all the sources that you cited that you used for this presentation, they're all from the 20th century, is that correct? There aren't any from within the last 15 years. Am I correct in that?
Right.
Okay. Now, what I wanted to ask you about is in the sources that you read, did you read any documentation about why the U.S. government made the decision to drop two atomic bombs on Japan? Did you read any information where there was actual decision
why there was two?
I'm not talking about why Japan surrendered.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Did you read anything about why they dropped atomic bombs on Japan?
Well, the reason they dropped two is because I told you they wanted to give the impression that we had the capability of making these all day long.
Excuse me, Bob. Oh, no, go ahead. I apologize. I interrupted you. I broke the one fool at a time. My bad. Go ahead. I apologize.
So that's why, and they were going to make six or seven more. They had orders in for six or seven more, but they're going to take a while to be done. There was even some thought that we would use them ahead of the invasion, the planned invasion of November 1st.
Uh-huh.
But, this, basically Roosevelt had already decided that we're going to make these bombs, and as soon as they're ready, we're going to use them. Because, when you're in a war, you're in it to win it. You're not, mm-hmm. So you're going to use everything at your disposal to bring this war to an end. So we wanted to come, our guys wanted to come.
All right, so you're aware that it was already in the works when FDR was president,
and
you know that they intended to use the bombs against Germany, but VE Day happened before.
We would have used them against Germany if they would have been available.
Okay.
And by the way, I should mention that this Kucinich article, and you see very often in several other articles, they always quote Eisenhower and MacArthur and Arnold and a couple other guys that all say, "Oh, that bombing, that was unnecessary. We didn't have to do that." Blah blah blah. Well, it's kind of curious why. First of all, as much as I respect Eisenhower, and as some of you know, I'm a blood relative of Eisenhower. Okay, his grandmother was Rebecca Mather. His great grandfather was Heinrich or Henry Mather, who was one of my great-great-something grandfather's brothers. So I'm kind of a distant cousin of Eisenhower. I've read about Eisenhower. I really love the man. He's respect him. He's a great character. And I'm really surprised at him saying such a thing. But he wrote that in 1963. And at that point, we were well into the Cold War. It was probably, I'd say, not politically correct to be in favor of atomic bombs at that time, because a lot of the religious speakers at the time, and the Pope and everything, were saying that that if the Germans had dropped an atomic bomb, we would have been convicting them of war crimes and all this stuff. It was being framed as a criminal act. But as far as, he'd become a politician. MacArthur had political aspirations, and all these guys in the military, their world was changing rapidly in front of them. The atomic bombs, all of a sudden, could make the Army obsolete, and the Navy obsolete, and the Air Force would be supreme. So there was a lot of, people protecting their turf. And of course, MacArthur wanted to be president. And he wanted to be the victor of World War II. Not the Manhattan Project. He wanted it to say MacArthur wins World War II, not the bomb. Okay. So of course he's going to say, "Oh no, we didn't need that bomb. I could have done it myself." He wanted to march on the shore and have his photograph taken and splattered all over. And so for a big campaign picture opportunity.
Okay. All right, Charlie had his hand up. Go ahead, Charlie.
Yeah. Bob, are you at all familiar with the concept of siege warfare?
Oh, yeah.
In which armed conflict is brought to a swift conclusion with little or no loss of life on either side.
Well, that...
And as took place in our own Revolutionary War.
If you go back to siege warfare, back to the First Crusade,
same thing.
A lot of the Crusaders would ring around a palace or something, and wait it out, and basically starve those people to death until they gave up. People would still die from starvation and lack of medical care.
Did the British at Yorktown starve to death?
No.
No, thank you.
Okay. All right, Kevin, go ahead.
Excellent presentation.
Okay.
Do you know anything about Germany as it lost the war, sending one or two submarines to Japan with the results of their atomic research and, you know, to let the Japanese maybe use it.
No, I don't know about their relation in that area. I know they gave them or sold them the blueprints for Messerschmitts and the jet technology. And Japan had, you know, basically bought the license or something to produce that technology of Japan. But as far as their atomic research and all that,
I believe that happened.
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt it. And I know that the people that were working in the nuclear field in Germany were highly sought after by our own OSS people and also the Russian Secret Service, or whatever they were called, the equivalent of the KGB.
Well, there was two, if I may. First, the KGB was actually at that time called the NKVD, and their job was they were the secret internal security police of the Soviet Union. The Russian military intelligence was called the GRU.
During World War II. Of course, everybody was trying to find these nuclear scientists and get them to their country as quick as possible. I think we won.
All right. Sir, did you have a question?
Yeah. Truman was only in office for 82 days as president. Do you think he had the foreign policy experience and the knowledge to make such a decision?
Truman?
Sure.
Yeah. Well, he didn't really make the decision. So he was just going along with what was already.
He was president. He could make his own decision.
Yeah. He was all set to go with it. I mean, he was on board. He wanted to continue right along the path that Roosevelt had already laid out. And by the way, when Truman made his first appearance as president in front of the Congress, he said that he was, you know, determined to make Japan surrender unconditionally, and he got a very long standing ovation. The American public was all behind the unconditional surrender.
All right, Wes?
What do you think is the possibility of future atomic bombings?
Well, probably what's going to happen is sooner or later Islamofascists are going to get a hold of atomic weapons, probably from Pakistan, and hit either us or England, or possibly maybe even as we see, you know, France gradually taken over, by Muslims. Basically, they won't have to forcibly take the weapons; they'll just vote themselves in power, in control. That would be probably probably within the next 100 years.
Doug. Or I'm sorry, you're Russell. I apologize. Yeah. Go ahead.
And more likely it'd be Iran, and the real target would be Tel Aviv.
That's also very likely. Yeah, I think Iran. That's a big problem. I've been tossing around the idea of maybe we should have a first strike against Iran. Maybe North Korea, that's also a big word. It's a troublesome time out there. Big issues to think about.
Okay.
All right. One clue at a time, y'all. Okay, Doug Binkley had a question. Go, Doug Binkley.
Is it possible, do you think, that the actual use of the two weapons, because of the destruction and the loss of life, it had more of an impact on reluctance to use them in war afterwards, in the period after 45?
It certainly did.
Rather than just a test.
They got bigger and badder, and when people see those videotapes, or film strips of the tests, that made people a lot more afraid to use them.
Does anybody else have a question who has not? Tim, go ahead.
Yeah, I'd like to know. I mean, I know we have our own controversy with our atomic bomb program on Japan, but wasn't it rumored that Japan had an active atomic weapons program, and that there was also reports from there was an actual detonation in the Korean Peninsula from their atomic weapons program?
That I did not encounter that. I mean, I knew they had an atomic program. I didn't know that they had, you know, got it to testing
it's
stage.
It's been rumored.
Okay. Oh, it's rumored. Yeah, no, I didn't hear anything about that. What I read was that they thought that they needed a lot more uranium than they really needed, so they kind of put the kibosh on.
I need to mention one other thing that
ironically here, even after we dropped the bombs, there were still some military people in Japan, some Japanese army guys, that were rushed to Tokyo and were trying to convince the other military leaders that that these bombs aren't that bad. That if people that were in the slit trenches were okay. If you were underground, no problem. They were trying to. I couldn't believe I was reading this. That they're telling these military people, hey, we can still do the Ketsugo thing. All we got to do is if you hear an airplane, just go down to the bomb shelter and you come out when it's all done, and you'll be okay. And matter of fact, right next to the Mitsubishi plant in Nagasaki, there was a slit trench there for American prisoners that were working. And when they heard the planes, they got down in the hole, and except for like eight of them stood up to watch. Most of them were okay. There was maybe 40 of them were injured, but a couple hundred of them survived just laying down there in the ground. But basically, if you were covered or behind a wall or something that didn't collapse on you, you came out of it okay. The business with the radiation, you had to be right there, had to pass right through you for the radiation to mess up your platelets. But you didn't get ill from being near contaminated areas or anything like we see on TV.
Listen, if I can ask a follow-up, you just mentioned it passing Nagasaki. Now, Nagasaki, you said, had a Mitsubishi plant. What did they make at the Mitsubishi plant?
I think airplane engines.
Okay, just a second. Aircraft engines. Okay.
I think it was aircraft.
Okay, gotcha. Now, did Hiroshima have anything in it that could be considered a legitimate military target?
Yeah, that was the headquarters of the 2nd General Army.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, the leader of it was injured during the bombing, but not killed.
Bob Lichtenberg.
Weren't there any strictly military targets that the U.S. could have decided to nuke? And it was Truman who made the decision that
Roosevelt was going to drop the bombs. I think maybe Truman might have gave the go-ahead to which targets to take. They had several targets picked out.
Now, why did they pick a civilian one? Why did they pick on cities when there's, tens of, maybe hundreds of thousands of innocent people would be burned alive and, evaporated? Why cities?
Well, like I said, these both had... They made an impact, and they did have military significance as well. They did have military significance, but it made an impact for them to see just how bad it was. As a matter of fact, there was even a sort of a blackout. Japan tried to black out the news of Hiroshima from everywhere else, but because of the train system, word spread, people knew. But a lot of people in Nagasaki, the day when a couple planes flew over, they just figured, two planes, that's nothing. That's probably lost planes or just weather planes or reconnaissance, nothing to worry about. They didn't realize that only two or three planes would fly over and drop an atomic bomb. As a matter of fact, some people saw the bomb come out on a parachute. They thought it was a man coming on a parachute, and one of the police commandants ordered somebody to go pick up that parachutist when he hit the ground. And so some people were standing there with binoculars watching him, thinking it was a guy when it was the bomb coming down.
All right, now there's Tom.
Yeah, I seem to recall reading that Truman
did not know about the bomb, nothing about the bomb until after he was president.
Yeah, that's true.
So how could he, so therefore, he didn't learn any of this. He didn't know anything ahead of time before he was president. He never knew anything about the bomb.
Right, and some days afterwards, then he was briefed on what was going on with the Manhattan Project and everything.
All right, now I see some other people who had questions have their hands up. But before, Andy, go ahead.
Yeah, Bob. Did you, in all your research, did you run across any of the large body of retired military people who said, we learned from those two bombs that they should never be used on cities again? I have a two-part question. One is, did you run across that body of knowledge? And two, all the good information you gave us tonight, how does this pertain to what we can do to make the world better today with what's going on in the Middle East and everywhere else? How does your talk pertain to helping citizens move forward and make America a better place today, if at all?
Well, I think that's probably for you guys to decide.
Yeah.
I think the best thing you could probably do is vote for Donald Trump on November
8th. Oh. Trump.
Okay, well, that's too foreign.
Gary Johnson.
All right. Victor.
Hang on.
A little bit.
Okay, go ahead, Victor.
About the emperor and that's the living God. He wasn't that innocent. I mean, the way I see it,
he was not that innocent. Everything had a stamp of approval. Well, his stamp of approval up until to the very end. And as a matter of fact, he came up with the idea of he was even thinking about having another invasion of China towards the end of the war. You know, sort of as a I don't know what for, but he got the military guy said, no, that's not going to work. He was kind of on board with everything until, when he realized that he looked like, hey, this is not going to work. This is going to end very badly. And then he decided.
And so we gave him a pass because we needed him to control Japan?
Well, yeah, that was the thinking. We thought, well, you know what? Having him around might help us ensure that we could get all these Japanese that are stationed all over Asia to cooperate and lay their guns down and stop fighting us. So a lot of these guys out there, they were gung-ho military. They had that mindset that death was preferable to surrender.
Wasn't there a Japanese discovered on an island still fighting?
Oh, yeah.
In 1974.
Okay, all right, let's, now, Charlie has his hand up, but before we go to a second round of questions, is there anybody who has a question who has not already asked a question? Okay. No? All right, then let's go to, okay.
Realistically, we're going to have to start cutting it off to get into rebuttals first.
Okay, all right, now Tim, do you think we should stop the questions now? Wait, let's get, let Ernie have a chance.
Let's
go
Ernie
ahead,
and then Charlie.
Bob.
Yes.
Great presentation, lots of research that you went through on this, but I'm a little bit, as far as the validity of the facts, I'm a little concerned. You threw out a lot of numbers, a lot of issues, and I'm wondering what comments you have on your confidence in the validity of all of these facts. In particular, you made the allegation that Japanese commanders would kill some of their own troops to use for food. That's one I'd never heard before, and it sounds a little extreme to me, even under the circumstances.
Well, I actually saw a documentary film about that in Facets, and that's what made me think of it. There was an island somewhere that had been cut off from their food shipments for quite a while, and some of the officers had some enlisted men killed, and then they ate them. And then they sent letters when things started moving again, or maybe radio, maybe they did a radio transmission or whatever, but they sent letters that, that said that these men were killed, died valiantly, you know, in battle and what have you. Well, some of the relatives started looking at the dates that they received these letters and when these supposed battles took place, and they did some research and they found out that there was no battles on those islands at that time. So something else was going on. But this was well after the war. A lot of people had died already and stuff. We couldn't talk about it. Okay. But they did reach one or two officers that were still alive, and these guys confessed to what they had done. And again, and when you're starving, it's if you ever read, you should read Collapse by Jared Diamond.
Jared Diamond,
yeah. When you're starving, you will eat people. The Heart of the Sea by Nathaniel Philbrick about the whale ship Essex. I mean, yeah, you'll eat people when you're hungry enough. Matter of fact, you're starting to look pretty good to me. I haven't had dinner yet myself. Picturing you with an apple in your mouth.
All right. Well, listen, I'm sure that it is. All right. There's one other person who has a question. TJ, what happened to Tojo?
Tojo,
the dictator. The head of the army.
The main culprit.
He was dead before the end of the war, but I'm not sure.
No, that's not true. Can I tell TJ what happened to Tojo? All right. Hey, everybody, please, one fool at a time. And right now I'm the fool. Okay, TJ, after the war ended, after Japan signed the treaty, the United States military occupied Japan. Tojo, who was the head of the army, was put on trial for war crimes, and he was sentenced to death. Now, shortly before he was supposed to be executed, he attempted suicide. However, our medics in our armed forces saved his life so that he could be executed on schedule.
I'm thinking, you know, he was removed from his position before the war ended, I think.
No, that I did not know about.
I think 43.
No. All right. Now I have been 44. Informed. Now, excuse me. I have been informed by the boss we're out of time, and we're going to have to. Okay. All right, Charlie.
This guy's
you're last. Okay, Charlie, you go ahead.
Go ahead, Charlie.
All right, Bob. All week long, I'm told that Muslims are dangerous.
Yep.
And then I'm told that Mexicans are dangerous. And then I come here and you tell me that Japanese are dangerous. Now, do you think it's totally appropriate to marginalize the enemy and engage in moral calculus, which justifies ultimately every action you would like to do?
Well, the Japanese were dangerous at that time, until we...
Every ethnic group is dangerous.
Yeah, well, probably with the exception of Lithuanians, I don't think they've ever presented a danger to anybody.
What about them Italians?
Romans have a background. But, any ethnic group, has that potential to be powerful. They don't even have to be ethnic. I mean, look at Muslims. I mean, you don't have to necessarily be ethnic. It's just this what they call a religion with this cult of, it's really a cult of oppression.
Are Bernie supporters dangerous?
All right. Now we're really running out of time here, folks.
Let's go to
So let's give a big hand for our speaker, Bob Matter. Okay.
My next speech probably sometime next year will probably likely be on another topic, another war topic. This time. About the Civil War. I'm going to reverse the direction and go backwards. I just got this excellent book called Emancipating Slaves, Enslaving Free Men by Jeffrey Rogers Hummel. And I just got it today. I'm planning on reading it. Maybe I'll give a speech on this. But you'll be interested to know that This book was written in 1996, and the editor was our own David Ramsey Steele, who spoke often here, which I did not know until I got this book today and read that in the preface.
Okay.
All right. Now let's go to the rebuttal period. Now, first of all, how many people want to speak? Everybody wants to speak. Raise your hand. Okay. That's all right. So that's one. Okay. That's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, and okay, so that's 11 people. Tim, I'm mathematically challenged. How does that
if
work out?
If we go to 4 minutes.
4 minutes.
And everybody don't maximize their 4 minutes.
Okay.
I think we'll have several people be short, but let's go. I got a timer here.
Okay.
So go ahead and start.
All right. First, Joe.
4 minutes for Patriots, 2 minutes.
First off,
traitors.
12 years ago, I spoke on this same topic at the college. Okay. So, it's not new. Second,
Wait,
let's think the B-29 fire raids on Tokyo, and there were four major ones, killed approximately 250,000 people. These were conventional raids, low level, at night, hurting people. So far, even the Japanese government can't tally 250,000 casualties from Hiroshima and Nagasaki over all these years. So, my speech was the humane uses of tactical nuclear weapons. And it was originally intended to be a joke, but as it turns out, it wasn't one. Now, somebody asked about how come we don't hear about what happened to the Japanese leaders when it came to war crimes. Very few were tried by the Tokyo Tribunal, because in the Pacific, they did it differently. Each of the Allied countries, as they caught people, held their own tribunals and hung them. MacArthur in the Philippines probably hung about 600 people. The British were real close, and the Australians and New Zealanders were definitely in third and fourth place and close to it. You'd have to go through the records of each individual country to find out just how many people they tried and hung for war crimes. But there were more of them hung in the Pacific than there ever were in Germany. So, that's the way it goes. As for biological warfare and the joke about the Japanese, they didn't mean it. Well, the unit was Unit 721 in China and Manchuria, and they experimented on mostly Chinese prisoners, civilians, whatever, and also Allied prisoners. And they tried everything. You'd name the disease, they tried it. They actually made Mingla at Auschwitz look almost benevolent. And that's how bad it was. So, like it or not, they were a problem. The Allies were looking at probably 1 million casualties just invading Japan to conquer it. The British wanted to be a part of the first invasion, but not the second one, because they couldn't afford the manpower loss anymore. The Allies in the Pacific, however, wanted Japan burned to the ground. And they were talking unbelievable numbers of people for casualties. American estimates for American casualties alone would have probably been 500,000 dead and probably 2 million wounded for both invasions. Hideous numbers. But the Japanese, you gotta remember, the Japanese army in the home islands had not been defeated. They did not believe they were going to lose the war. The islands and Manchuria and China didn't matter. But the home islands, that mattered.
Time's up.
That's just the way it went. They were not going to quit.
Time's up. Okay, I'll go next.
All right, who wants to be next?
I'll be next.
You started out factual and then you lost it.
No, I didn't lose it.
You see, a lot of times we may think we can debate whether we can go back and debate our history as to whether or not we should have bombed or should not have bombed Pearl Harbor. The thing we should be talking about now is what, since the genie is out of the bottle, and nuclear has been around for well over 40 years and provides about 20% of our power, we should be talking more about the peaceful uses of nuclear energy and what this can do for us in the future. What you may not know is during that time of the Manhattan Project, a gentleman by the name of Glenn Seaborg, when he came in, was looking for a certain fissionable elements. One of those happened to be uranium-U-233, which is what happens when you bombard thorium with free neutrons. And then it becomes a fissile material, and it's a little bit more powerful than uranium-U-235. But with uranium-233, when you get the decay from thorium, there also happens to be a lot more nasty stuff with it that would fry out the electronics of any bomb tried to be making from it. With the proper type of nuclear reactor, you could very simply make one that's safe, one that will not have weapons proliferation, that is not ready for meltdown, and can be made and mass-produced in the Gen 4 reactor configuration with a modular design that could help us get our energy future on track. What I'm going to simply say is this. Thorium power has been known since the beginning of the Manhattan Project. The source of the molten salt reactor has been around since about the 1940s and was researched at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory by a gentleman by the name of Alvin Weinberg. These reactors were tested back in the 60s, and in 1973, all research was abandoned in favor of the fast breeder. Because we did that, I think we lost out on a rather significant opportunity to make a real solvable and real potential to solve the climate change problem, to provide cheap energy to many of our around the world, and in a sense prevent the war. The atom is not the problem. Nuclear energy and knowledge of nuclear energy is not the problem. It's how we choose to use it.
Fukushima's not a problem.
Fukushima, Charlie, was an accident waiting to happen because of a bad design from a light water reactor that was not built to specs.
Yeah.
But if you really look at it, Charlie, the nuclear industry is probably one of the most best safety records in the world.
Yeah, like 3 Mile Island.
And 3 Mile Island didn't really kill anybody. If you look at back at the fossil, anyway, Charlie, I'm not going to go on. What I'm simply saying is this. Thorium power and the light water, and I'm sorry, and the molten salt reactor has the potential to save the world from global warming, provide almost a millennium of energy future. There is so much thorium in the world that there would be an end to our resource wars, and the reactors can be made safe and modular. Thank you.
Adam is wonderful.
That's right.
Sorry, Adam.
Next.
Adam. Hi, Doug Binkley here. I think my liberal credentials are kind of known to people, but I'm not one of these super liberals that just does a knee-jerk, dropping the bombs must have been bad. I've gone back and forth on this issue. It's very complicated, of course. Bob Manner did a very good job, my good friend Bob Manner here, even though he's a right winger. On this issue, I come down on his side. I do believe that the...
Not so close to the microphone.
Sorry. I do believe that the evidence is that the dropping of the bombs was justified. We had already, the war had come to the point where civilians were being killed on both sides in a casual manner, you might say. These bombs did fake the Japanese into surrendering. It is true, we only had three bombs. Plutonium and uranium 235 were very hard to make in any quantities, and the best option we had to avoid those immense casualties, it was estimated that 1 to 2 million would die in the invasion. And if it had not succeeded to fake out, we would have had to wait a good bit of time to get another bomb. We had to use one for a test, and then of course the second one that was used, which was the one on Hiroshima, really had to be used without announcing it, because they could have shot the plane down. If we tried a demonstration, yes, it could have fizzled, it could have been a dud. So all of these things that Bob was talking about were very serious considerations. Truman did make the right call. Had he not done so, and later it was revealed we had this weapon and could have used it, but instead we had enormous casualties, he would have perhaps been impeached. He certainly wouldn't have been reelected. Political considerations beside the point, and humanitarian consideration, which I had not been fully aware of, that they might have starved, more Japanese might have starved, as Bob brings out, that even makes more evidence in favor that the decision to drop the bombs was correct. And also I have a personal reason, which is that my father was inducted into the Army. He was sent to Germany at the latter part of the war. He was luckily not involved in D-Day or any large battles. He just got in on the very end of that part of the war in Europe, but he was very well aware of the fact that he would have been in the front lines if there had been an invasion of Japan. So it is quite possible that I wouldn't be speaking to you today. Doug Binkley wouldn't have existed. My father would have died before he had a chance to conceive me. So in that respect, again, I have a selfish reason for coming down in favor of Bob Manner's position.
Okay.
One of my favorite quotes out of history, it's been repeated by millions of people around the world, it is, those who cannot learn from history are doomed to repeat it. And General Smedley Butler, the most decorated Marine general in history, wrote a book called War is a Racket. It was published early in 1935 and republished by his descendants in 2003, and the current edition is 2013. But it talks about big corporations making enormous profits by selling to both sides of the combatants in a war. Right now, we're inundated with reality-based scientific reports coming out from all different sides showing that climate change and global warming is real. It's happening now. It's caused by burning fossil fuel all over the world. And the U.S. military, with its 800 bases, is one of the largest polluters on the planet. Capitalism itself is at war with the environment. The nuclear power, there's an article just showed up, I think Harvey Wasserman wrote it. He said nuclear power not only cannot make any contribution towards solving the greenhouse effect, if you want to destroy the environment, you would just promote and spend money on nuclear power. It forecloses all the cheaper options that can be implemented 10 times faster to get us off fossil fuel. Molten reactors, molten salt reactors like Tim talks about,
were researched and abandoned back in the 70s for a very good reason. Molten salt reactors have incredible corrosion problems, all kinds of stuff. But the nuclear industry is dead and dying, and it's not going to be resuscitated anytime soon. So we should spend our time promoting what they're teaching seventh graders out where I coach, that the future belongs to solar and wind power, if we have a future. Also, they learned something in World War II about the explosive power of atomic bombs. Things get smaller, lighter, and more compact. By the mid-80s, the power of the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs, that kind of explosive power could be contained and carried around in something the size of a football. You could carry a Hiroshima blast in a backpack, one off the road, 12 backpacks loaded onto 12 motorcycles and delivered to 6 cities, 6 nuclear power plants. You could eliminate the United States as a place for human habitation with a dozen motorcycles. As he said, if you don't mind paraphrasing the commercial, Kawasaki lets the good times roll. There we are. We're right up at the brink of extinction. And there's a book called The Sixth Extinction talking about the loss of all kinds of diversity all over the world because of the militarization, the globalization of 800 bases and the very, very large crimes against humanity that are being visited on the people in the Middle East. How many people here know that since October of 2005, Iraq and Afghanistan have been considered uninhabitable for humans because of the radioactive dust dispersal weapons that have saturated the air, water, ground, and soils? That women can't have healthy babies in those countries anymore. They are uninhabitable for humans long term. And our oil companies want to put up automated pumping stations and control the resources. So this whole myth is being driven by the myth of 9/11, that we have to fight terrorism everywhere.
Yeah.
Puncture that myth, and we got $1 trillion a year to spend on things that would help people. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, boy, Andy.
Sometimes it's good to put a personal face on these major issues. Doug Binkley has already done that for us. And I think I've told this story before, but I have a kind of a personal face too. Turns out my ex-father-in-law was in the theater at the time that the A-bomb was dropped, and his unit was not only scheduled to invade, they were scheduled to go on a ship right into Yokohama Harbor, kind of as a diversion to for the troops that were really hoping to invade, which means, you know what, 90% plus casualties. That means with no father-in-law, no ex-wife, and two of the wonderful sons I have now, wouldn't be here. So,
could I add
thank you, Harry Truman.
Wait, one fool at a time.
Okay. First off, I want to thank our speaker tonight for an uncommonly good, well-prepared presentation. The fact that I happen to agree with 99% of what he said is immaterial. It was a well-done job. Truth of the matter is, if you look back 100 years ago, the horror weapon that we were all afraid of, the world was afraid of, was poison gas. Poison gas was used extensively by both sides on the Western Front during the First World War. After the First World War, it was decided, even though for generations everyone in the military carried a gas mask, poison gas was not used extensively on any battlefields in the West. It was a horror weapon that people did not want to touch again. Now, we can hope that the same attitude applies toward nuclear weapons. The fact that we have now developed weapons that even the generals are afraid of using. Never mind that Donald Trump is not afraid of using them. Never mind that he asked, why can't we use nuclear weapons? The fact of the matter is, there are a number of people on the Joint Chiefs of Staff who would be more than happy to take him into a closed padded cell where he could better understand what is at stake here. I don't think we have much to worry about an organized nation using nuclear weapons today, because the people running organized nations, whether we happen to agree with them or not, generally are mature enough and aware enough to know that these things should not be touched. I think the thing that we have to worry about, and it was touched by a previous speaker, are the people that have found ways to take nuclear weapons, make them the size of hand grenades, and go into public places and create acts of terror that we don't even want to imagine. These are the bad guys we have to worry about in the future. It used to be the bad guys, we knew their address, we knew where to find them, and we knew where to deliver swift retribution should that ever become necessary. In this particular case, we're dealing with people, number one, they're not afraid to die. I don't know about anyone here. I am uncomfortable around someone who is not afraid to die, because he is perfectly willing to risk his life and all of our lives. And I, for one, admit I am afraid to die, and I'm not too anxious to leave this planet anytime soon. I think I speak for a lot of people. We have to learn to deal with amateurs, with freelancers who are going into public places with bombs. Someday, sooner rather than later, mark my words, they're going to be nuclear. It's only a matter of time. It can now be done in a garage by any good physics student. And what do we do to make the world safe in a situation like that? The obvious answer would be to obliterate groups like ISIS. But we aren't having too much luck with that, at least not as much luck as we would like. They're still around. And new groups of fanatics are developing and will develop in the future when the next major wars are to be continued.
Tonight was a historic occasion. Delete ventured into the comments about Islamofascism. I found that I was in agreement with virtually everything that Bob Manor had to say. It was a very well rehearsed, very well executed, very well planned presentation. I thank you for that, Bob. The only things that I would point out are A, General MacArthur was in command only in the Southwest Pacific. The commander of in the Central Pacific was the commander-in-chief of the Pacific Fleet and Pacific Ocean Area's Admiral Nimitz.
Right.
And that's why in the Central Pacific it was the Navy and the Marines that did most of the fighting. General MacArthur was active in the Philippines and in the rest of the Southwest. Also, with regard to whether we should have staged a demonstration of the A-bomb first, there was also pointed out that, well, the Japanese might just move some of those Allied prisoners of war into the target area. And so that was one reason why President Truman decided not to stage a demonstration first, and that there should be a first strike with no warning. Second, why should cities be destroyed? People forget that when you start a war, the only way to get you to stop it is by committing bigger and bigger acts of murder until finally you're appalled by the bloodshed and want to stop. Second, when you put a military anything, like headquartering an army or putting a target industry into the middle of a city or a town, that makes it a military target straight up. In other words, if the Japanese had the resources, they would have been justified, for example, in bombing Highland Park and Highwood. Why? Because Fort Sheridan was there. And in the 40s, that was an active army post. My dad went there for basic training. And the same within the places in the south where Fort Bragg is and the rest of that, Fort McClellan and the rest of that. And third, with regard to the Japanese attempts to use biological warfare, they also tried sending balloons over to the West Coast to start forest fires. Fortunately, most of those turned out to be duds and didn't accomplish anything. And as was pointed out, that like the Germans, they used prisoners of war for sadistic medical experiments, not only with biological warfare, but all kinds of other stuff. And also, there was one point that you didn't touch on in your talk. I've also heard it talked about that we bullied the Japanese into striking at Pearl Harbor. And I think that's a lot of bullshit myself. What we essentially told them was that if they didn't take their army out of China, we were going to stop selling them strategic materials like scrap iron and oil.
Right.
And we were under no obligation to trade with these people. And if they wanted to continue fighting in China, well, then they were going to have to do it without our supplies. And the Japanese then decided, what fascists everywhere have decided, well, if the U.S. isn't going to trade with us, we're going to march right into somewhere, into the islands and take this stuff. And that's essentially what they did. And so Pearl Harbor was an unprovoked attack. President Roosevelt was quite right when he called it an unprovoked and dastardly attack. Finally, or initially, I would also point out that the Japanese also had built speedboats that they were going to use against us if they invaded. And these were one-way speedboats. They were loaded with explosives. Mm-hmm. And finally, we also used the A-bombs when we had nothing else left. The Battle of Okinawa showed us there was no longer a war of the professionals, which had previously been the case. That if we, all right, to be continued.
All right, Charlie.
All right, let's thank our speaker, Bob. Anything here?
One more.
All right. I'll be very quick. The instantaneous incineration of 100,000 people or more is an activity which cannot be justified under any circumstances. I say so as a member of the War Resisters League and secretary of the Chicago chapter, which was established right here at the College of Complexes. Killing people does not save lives. That is illogical. Am I somehow able to comprehend this when you're not? Killing people does not save lives. There was discussion at the onset of World War II in the 30s about this aerial warfare and the bombing of cities and civilian targets. And they called it carpet bombing. There was plenty of ethical discussion. It got thrown away because the air warfare was at 40,000 feet. They couldn't get targets. They couldn't ascertain targets from that height, miles above there. There was just absolutely no way. They didn't know what they were. And it evolved, they didn't care. And then from there it evolved the firestorm, the incendiary bombs and weapons. And in Japan they were using the firestorm. They took all the machine guns out of the super flying fortresses, loaded them up with these incendiary things, and they had no more targets. Curtis LeMay had no viable targets. Because there was a Japanese soldier in that city, you say, well, that's justified. What kind of target? You lost 100,000 people to get who or what? What target? They didn't have any more. They were bombing at will. There was no justification. And then again, to say that we are going to kill 100,000 people, this is the worst kind of... Listen, there's fair... You got to think about ethics. You have to have a categorical imperative and remain solidly stick to it. And that is that we do not advocate or authorize the killing of other people. Now to say, well, we can do this because, oh, I'm going to do this and this, and I hear them to tell stories, and oh, it's beneficial that, you know. No, it is not like dough. Ethics is there's a right and a wrong activity, and it doesn't flop all over the place. And this moral calculus is so inherently dangerous. Dispose of it. You can authorize any activity if you want to.
You can do whatever you want. Well, guess what? In real ethics, you cannot do whatever you want, whenever you want. Avoid that altogether. These are nefarious things, and they should have not been used, and they all have used. Why there isn't, what is your justification for the worst thing that of our invention of human technology that we could come up as a species? This is what we've come up with. Why doesn't people get together collectively and say, no, this was a mistake, it should never have been used, and hopefully it'll never be used anyway. Your turn, Tom. Okay. Thank you very much.
Well,
your lesson. I sound like a preacher.
We have less than 15 minutes left.
Yeah.
So if you want to kill people, if we can cut it down to 3 minutes between you and Bob, that's not a problem.
Yeah.
So, and Bob, you're going to have to keep here within about 5 to 6 minutes.
Oh, yeah. I want to give more time to Bob.
Well, I just wanted to thank Bob for the great speech he gave here tonight. And I did disagree with him on one thing, though. That was, he's for Mr. Trump, and that bothers me.
It would bother
I guess history
state,
teaches
man.
Lessons that we go away with. And the lessons that we learned here, I think, is that, if you know, when World War II started, Japan bombed Hawaii, and this was a horrible act that happened against us, and we rose in a war against Japan over it. And when it came time to use the atomic bomb, we used it to end the war, not to start a war. So today, Mr. Trump wants to start a war with ISIS, or finish a war with it, continue a war with ISIS. He's talked about using nuclear weapons. He's talked about different things, and I don't agree with any of them. But that's neither here nor there. We need to use our heads. We need to recognize that people get mad over. We have 25 million people out of work in this country, either unemployed or underemployed. That's one of our problems. And we have angry people. So why are they angry? They don't have jobs. So we got to do something about it. We got foreign trade. We got tremendous amount of money invested, and you know, we owe different countries right now $57 billion, $19 trillion, where our national debt is not very good. So we got to do something about that. So maybe we need to put tariffs on corporations, but we can't do that because we got a Congress that's owned by the corporations, and corporation controlling government is by definition fascism. I heard that mentioned tonight too.
Oh.
That's not a good thing. So Maybe we need to put tariffs on corporations so they will produce in this country instead of other countries. We'd have some jobs here. Then we might be able to shorten the workday down the road, and we'd have a better society. And we would have less cause for war and less cause for different things happening to us. Anyway, I better shut up while I'm ahead. Thank you.
Okay.
Bob.
Okay, listen,
I'll
hear your
turn. First, I'd like to talk about the effects of a nuclear bomb. What is the worst effect of a nuclear bomb? The worst effect, is it the fire, the heat, in other words, the destruction, toppling of cities, buildings? What's the worst effect, anybody? None of those are the worst. Does anyone know what the worst effect is, Bob? What's the worst effect?
The worst effect?
Yeah, of a nuke.
Radiation.
Well,
it depends on how close you are.
Radiation. Who said radiation? Radiative. Right, exactly. That's a killer. That's a killer. It kills the earth, it destroys the earth, pollutes the earth, makes it unfit for habitation, and kills humans. If it gets inside of you, if you ingest it or inhale it, you get leukemia or some other deadly form of cancer. So it's a horrible weapon. It's a terrible weapon, but it's here, and it won't go back. It's, you know, with Pandora open the box, it's common knowledge. But bombing cities is just out of the question in my mind, as how that could be ethical. You kill hundreds of thousands of innocent people. Many years later, they were still dying in a horrible death. You know, leukemia is no fun. If they weren't burned alive first. And those were firecrackers that we dropped. They're much bigger
on us are better. But
step away from the mic a little.
But Japan was defeated. You know, there weren't a million of Americans are going to die. But Bob documented how little the Japanese had in terms of military. They weren't going to beat us. No way. No way were they going to beat. They were beat. They were really beat terribly. And Truman decided to drop the bomb, and somebody said that. So he could get reelected, you know, kick the Japs' ass, you know, as hard as he could, so he could be voted in again. He was a country hick. Barack Obama, I guess my time's almost up. Barack Obama was recently visited Japan on the 50th anniversary of dropping the bomb, and the damn fool, or I should call him chicken, he didn't apologize. He should have apologized. He did call for nuclear abolition. They didn't do a damn thing about it. Our leaders need more courage. And so do we, to admit that we did a horrible thing. Thank you.
All right, Don, I'm going to give you 2 minutes.
Just 2 minutes? Well, we got until 8:45, so we can
you got to remember that we have to allow time for our speaker to close.
All right, no, 3 minutes for me. Okay, look, you got 3 minutes for Bob and 3 minutes for Tom. Bob,
go, go, go.
For Tom. So, all right. Listen, first of all, I thought that let's have a round of applause for our speaker, Bob Batter. Okay, I thought Bob did a really good job with the presentation, you know, and he did it without PowerPoint. But I'm not a big, you know, I don't believe that you need technology to solve everything. And now, there's, you know, a lot of people have already talked about the moral implications, Charlie and Bob Lichtenberg and well, Bob Manner too, our speaker. And this is an issue that has a lot of philosophical implications. Yeah, on the one hand, you have an epistemological, you know, you have the moral question of whether it's right or wrong to murder civilians if it leads to a greater good. And then you have the question, that there's an epistemological question, which we've had argued back and forth here, over what is a fact. I think Ernie kind of brought that up. And I would want to distinguish between facts and opinions. If I say that Japan sued for peace after the two atomic bombs were dropped, that's a fact. It happened in that order. If I say Doug Binkley's father would have been killed if they hadn't done that, that's not a fact. It's an opinion. Because maybe on the other hand, Doug Binkley's dad would have survived. We don't know. It's impossible to know what would have happened. And whenever we talk about that, we're speculating. Now the second thing, there is one other, I think Bob really had his facts down. There isn't a single thing that Bob said that in terms of facts, there isn't a single thing that Bob said that I couldn't disagree with. I do not agree with all of Bob's opinions. I don't really have time to go into everything. One thing that I would say, and this is both an epistemological issue but with moral implications, is that when you make generalizations about an ethnic group, for example, Bob generalized about Russians, how you can't trust them. Well, one must distinguish between the government and the people. You're talking about, what Bob was really talking about, I think, is the Soviet Union. Yeah, the Soviets couldn't be trusted. But I know many Russians, as individuals, who are good people. I've worked with Russians, and I got along with all of them. And now I'm being told that I am out of time. So I will now yield the floor to our speaker, Bob Mapp.
Thank you all for your attention tonight and all the compliments. I appreciate it. I want to make a comment here about the Russians. Another estimate is if the Russians, if we had not dropped atomic bombs and went ahead with an invasion or even the blockade, and the Russians were coming in. I mean, they were pouring into Manchuria. They were going to go to Hokkaido and then probably into Honshu. If
if the number of people that would have died were was in any in proportion to what happened in Manchuria, and another 400,000 Japanese would have died at the hands of the Russians. So again, you know, you'd have to look at what would have happened had we not dropped the bomb, with starvation and what have you, or with Russians killing in there, killing people. So. And the invasion would have been, there could have been anywhere from 30 or 50,000 dead during the first 30 days, as far as allies, to maybe a 500,000 or more by the time it was all done. Because remember, the Japanese had this reputation for fighting to the death. Anyway, I'm going to end tonight with a great quote that I ran across, and that is that the only thing that is certain is the future. The past is always changing. Thank you very much.
And that's a wrap. Let's have a good night, everybody, and we'll see you next week.